until 2 years ago, I was working on disaster studies. That was my research and specialization. But 2 years ago, the music has been my hobby. But 2 years ago, University of the Philippines College of Music suddenly asked me to teach Koto. It really changed my life. No? So I may say I'm reckless enough to come here to present this kind of presentation. I'm pretty new in this field. So today I'm just going to make a report about the Koto workshop and concert that me and Thai Sensei of the National University of Singapore organized in July this year. So first, traditional music in the context of globalization. What we have, what I think first is the traditional music is inevitably associated with national or ethnic identity. So talking about no kabuki, nobody questions these two genres are associated with Japan, I think. The Koto music is also a particular music to Japan, the Japanese identity at least. Next. Yeah, so pretty hard. Okay, then, music travel, across the borders, and, you can just go. From the very early stage of the history, music, music always travel across the border. But with the globalization, the speed, and then the expansion of transnationalization, globalization, transmission it increased. Yes. Next. Then the issues can include the universality of the particular gender in the international market, or particularization. This is for the consumption side. Then, national ethnic national or ethnic identity issues still remain in the production side. Then, this chart shows the two theoretical models of own music or others' music. I think the paper before me talked about Japanese professionals and then non-Japanese foreign amateur. This kind of dichotomy can be applied to the performance, performance genre. So the theoretically four combination can be, are possible. But then with the globalization, I think that this kind of categorization boundaries that are actually blurring right now. So what is own music, what is others' music, are actually in a certain area. No, a certain area, this category models can be effective, but a certain size of the performance, the boundary is blurring. So, hōgaku genre. thank you. So, if you look at the kanji character of hō, this is usually translated in Japanese. But if you look at the real meaning of the character, my interpretation is my country, which means Japan. So, hōgaku is music of my country, of Japan. So this concept was actually...
Carry on.
Yeah, next.
This
particular name came out during the Meiji period. The contrast, in contrast to Western music, which is Yoroku, I think the morning, if you, some papers also for consider Meiji period a very crucial period in the transmission of the tradition, tradition genre. The music, Japanese music, also came to the reconceptualization during the Meiji period. So that the Hōgaku genre is not just a music, but also it entails a whole system embedded in this particular genre repertoire, notation system, pedagogy, level certification, of course, including Iemoto Shihan system. Then, more symbolical level, different level, it also represents the national identity and implies claim of ownership of this genre and purity, assumed purity of Japanese music. Nowadays, if you go to CD shop, you may see yōgaku, hōgaku, but the hōgaku already include karaoke and Japanese pop. So to distinguish this tradition Japanese music, they put pure, jun, hōgaku. It really represents the pure essentialistic notion in Kitai. Last one. Recently, I heard this issue of Rokudan and Gregorian chant. The Rokudan no Shirabe is a famous koto piece. Almost all the koto practitioners should go through, learn this piece in the early stage of learning. But the one researcher came up with this new theory, Rokudan and the Gregorian chant has a certain musical similarity. The suggesting possibility is when Rokudan was composed, it was influenced by the European missionaries. I'm not talking about if this is true or not, but what I want to point out is this theory was reacted by the Sankyoku Hōgaku. Why you have to react violently? I think the background is that we believe Rokudan is really classic of classics of koto music, so that the purity should be with this piece. So I think that's the assumption. So in this context, the paper before me studying no by non-Japanese, but in the context is in Japan. It's maybe possible, but how about outside Japan? Is transmission and production, learning and performance of Hōgaku, performance is possible. Acquisition of Hōgaku and production possible outside Japan. So that's my question for this paper. Then my case study is koto music in Southeast Asia. So I quickly explain the station of koto music in three countries. First, Singapore. Singapore koto club existed in the 1980s. This Japanese Miss Sumiko Tani started koto club here in the university. Then she was not a resident, but then she just visited to teach. Then Koto. Yes, I see. Kotokot members here. Kotokoton was established nine by Saeko Kitai Saeko. She's a Shihan under Sawai Koto Institute. What I understand is this is basically a student organization here. Then the including graduate, it sustains as an independent group. So they perform frequently. I think they are preparing for a concert. Next month. Yeah. If you go to YouTube, you can find a lot of videos. The very splendid. Then Singapore has a Koto no Kai under Japanese Association. Singapore. So another member. So Koto no Kai was basically limited to the membership of Nihonjin Kai, Singapore. No? The group member, the 11 right now, they are also active. Then in Singapore, there is another group, Hibikia. Hibikia is like loosely organized network which include many subgroups. The some group do koto. The one shamisen to koto no kai plays shamisen and koto. Okay. So next, the Philippines. So the Philippines, Sawai Koto Institute donated instrument and instructor in 1991. This is I encountered Koto here this year in the Philippines. Then I started Koto. So after that, after instructor left, more than 10 years, it was inactive. No teacher, no student. But the Yamada school teacher, Midori Nishijima, she was a resident of the Philippines. She started teaching. Then she produced two Filipino instructors. So they were teaching Koto to Filipino students until 2015. Then I came in. Then Asian music program major in Koto was established in 2012. Then we have the Tuma Koto Ensemble. This is basically pretty active. Program currently has 10 Koto majors, 8 minors. Thailand. Oka Koto Group. This Oka is a cherry blossom in the kanji. They existed in Bangkok, then Noriko Tsuboi, the Shihan, and the Sawai Koto School, they came in, then she started teaching. Then, according to her, the 40 people study under her. The most 90% are Japanese. If you look at three elements of transmission: human resources, institutional agency, and social environment. The Philippines are pretty unique in terms of human resources and institutional support because it's formal. Then we have Filipino instructors. But the social environment, Singapore and Thailand has a relatively large Japanese community. And then the non-Japanese society also accommodate and enjoy Koto music. That's what the Philippines lacks. We Actually, I organized this Koto workshop because it's very hard to sustain Koto in the Philippines because I'm not a certified teacher, but I also need training. So when I met Kitai Sensei, I can learn. I don't need to go to Japan, and I can just come to Singapore, then I learn Koto from her, and our student can exchange the knowledge, you know, so they can create Koto network, you know, without Japanese support. Mm-hmm. So that was the initial idea. But it became a bigger event than I thought. We had a total of 34 participants from, with Master Kazue Sawai from the, founder of Sawai Koto School. She came over. And I think I like this picture because this picture doesn't any Japanese. Everybody is no Japanese. And we conducted a survey. How do Japanese? Basically, my focus is a non-Japanese opinion about Koto music and their future. I got a total number of 41 respondents. 39% Singaporean, 29 Japanese. Profile-wise, place of residence Singapore 32, the Philippines 5 people. The occupation, majority is student and employed. So the mode age in Japanese 40 to 49, the age bracket is really different. Not Japanese 20 to 29. The Koto experience, mode shows the Japanese people experience Koto more than 10 years, and while non-Japanese learned Koto just started after 5 years. So, motivation. Yeah, I like Koto, but non-Japanese, this is the second one. I like Japanese culture in general, so that's why they started. I found it very interesting. I wanted to use Japanese translation. I wanted to compare it with them. So that they're already musicians, the practicing of Chinese. Problems of studying Koto. So far expected. Hard to obtain instrument, other Koto goods, and Koto scores. Therefore, non-Japanese understanding Koto score in Japanese, it's written in Japanese, that's hard. I didn't understand the instructions. Something like that. Okay, so for this question, do you think you must study in Japan to become an advanced Koto player? How do you think? if you're no practitioner, do you think you have to go to Japan, or it's not necessary?
Mm-hmm. It's almost impossible either way.
Okay, that's another question. Okay, can you?
Sure.
So this is an answer of Japanese. Yes, 42%. Okay, non-Japanese. Japanese are more positive of studying outside. Actually, of course. Okay, next. Language. Do you need a high level of language to understand Japanese? How do you think?
No.
Oh, really?
No.
Non-Japanese. But you know, of course, Japanese recommended. It's not crucial, but they recommended to study Japanese so that you can understand more. Okay, it's next. only Japanese or non-Japanese who know Japanese culture well, not deeply, can become advanced. As you said, no, either way, no, you study in Japan or outside Japan, you cannot become, no professional or something, Koto, yeah, in this case, Koto player. So that's what I wanted to know, how they think, so Japanese. So, without knowledge of Japanese culture, you can be a good Koto player, Japanese. So this is not Japanese. The interesting thing is, yes, the non-Japanese think, more non-Japanese think that they have to know Japanese culture. This is a straightforward question. of course, non-Japanese are more positive. And then classical pieces like Rokudan, Miyagi Michio, Meiji period, he created a neo-Japanese music movement. Sawai Tadao he's a student of Miyagi Michio. He is my interpretation is his works mainstream with the contemporary innovation. His son, Hikaru Sawai, he's very popular right now. His pieces are more, what can I say? He came from rock. he's still a rocker. So his works really attract young people. In Japan, there is a Koto group, Sawai Hikaru wo Hiku Kai. Sawai Hikaru wo Hiku Koto no Kai. It's a Koto group, particular to the play Hikaru Sawai's works. And then contemporary pieces by contemporary Koto pieces by Japanese Koto musicians. This one is Koto pieces by Japanese composers other than Koto musicians, like Takemitsu Toru or Ichiyanagi. This one, Koto pieces by non-Japanese composers. So this is very particular Japanese don't want to play. arrangement is popular. Then this one, last one. I will make my own composition. So there are just summarize. The majority of the respondents start learning Koto because they like the music. Second, major issues include the difficulty in the physical aspect of the maintenance, the instrument, scores, restraint. Then secondly, the lack of support for learning teachers, score reading. Then both groups said the non-Japanese can become an advanced Koto player without the high level of language acquisition and study in Japan. Both groups said that being Japanese or knowing Japanese culture is not a prerequisite for the mastery of Koto music. Non-Japanese are more positive about the promotion of Koto music in Southeast Asia, mainly due to the popularity of Japanese culture, J-pop, or manga, or other things, and the existence of enthusiastic individuals like Kitai Sensei. So Japanese are uncertain about the promotion of Koto music. Due to the lack of environment and support that encourage and strengthen the learning of Koto. Japanese are not favorable to Koto pieces by non-Japanese composers, according to the survey. Personally, I'm very interested. Don't Japanese are not inclined to particular Koto pieces? So if you look at the distribution of answers, no particular trend. No. While majority showed the higher interest in classical music than Japanese do. No. So the non-Japanese Koto learners are actually interested in Rokudan or Midare or those classic. This may be the tentative conclusion because the Koto music in Southeast Asia has not been established. Then the respondents is only 41. This really shows the small community of Hogaku in Southeast Asia. So it's too early to conclude anything, but it may suggest this kind of thing. So the Koto music has been sustained mostly by human resources and teachers, the individual teachers, although the number is very small, less than five, less than 10, I may say, but this was supported by those individuals. Then local society that accommodate the popularity of Japanese culture. So the society, people are more interested in Japanese culture in general. Then learning of Koto music can be the extension. Please go back. So recognition of Japanese identity, the music is very clear. They like the music because it's part of Japanese culture. Its identity marker is very clear. The acquisition of cultural literacy other than music is not considered crucial by the practitioners. My point is this, the last one. Among non-Japanese practitioners, 20%, this is quite high, I may say, are positive to create their own Koto music. Without going to Japan, without learning the language outside the Japanese context, they are positive to create their own music. Tradition is continuous innovation. It was said by Hikaru Sawai. He said, "Sozo wa nandake? Dento wa sozo da." The outside the Japanese context, without the rigorous training system, knowledge transmission system. What's happening is this individual interpretation, discontinuation of tradition skills, some skills, and individual performance type. So deliberate innovation, those things are happening. Discontinuation tradition skills, I observed my student in Koto, what we call uraren is a very particular technique to Koto. Uraren is a combination of three movements, trill, then glissan, then the last note. It's a combination of three. In my observation, my students think this is a three separate movement. Then they stop after the trill, then glissan. No, it cannot be, but they don't listen to me, sorry. Especially when they try to compose, they really do that. They don't do the uraren. They cut the trill, then fermata, the pause, then glissan. So it's a kind of discontinuation of uraren. Then I actually prepared three examples of production. Do you have any
speaker?
First, I just explain. This is Thai production in Thailand. This piece is Jusigen and live electronic music performance composed by Thai composer Tanapon. He is not a Koto practitioner, but he is a close friend of Tsuboi sensei. Then second, I'm so hazukashi to put this. Thank you. Can you just stop? Stop it. This is Filipino horror movie. So I was so surprised when the director approached me that asked me to compose a score for this. This nothing about Japan, nothing. I don't know that if he knew I play Japanese instrument. Then he just came to me. Then I just said yes. Then in 2 weeks we did a recording. Then the movie was the film was already released. So this is one of the examples that the Koto music created outside Japanese context. The last one is
before that.
You want me to go?
No, just explain it.
Okay.
So this is very interesting work. Although the music, musical was still half baked, but my student tried to combine the Philippine instrument and Koto. So, interesting. How many minutes do I have? I just showed it.
We start at 2:15. So about 30 minutes, actually. We've
covered much. I just need
to meet. For the.
I'm sorry. We just noticed that this session should also be 45 minutes. So we will end at about 3, and then you have coffee.
Yes.
Yeah.
I hope you can hear.
Pagpapasok ko lang sa inyo yung pangalan ng kulay. Gusto ko lang maniwala ka sa akin dahil kahit ako natatakot ka. Tara na.
Basic question.
Yeah.
In the surveys, the questions go nani nani. Then advanced koto player. So, what is an advanced koto player?
It's very hard to say because it's and I cannot use the professional. The koto professional means you earn make living on the performance and teaching. The teaching koto, the Singaporean, the Filipino, the teaching koto in their own country, it's there is no the as of now I don't see the possibility. So becoming koto professional is as of now it's not positive in the Philippines. So I cannot use that term. Yeah. Some people interpret it as Shihan, the certified certification. But my experience, if you don't belong to a particular school, you never get it. Mm-hmm. In my case, I don't get that certification. So it's also difficult to say you want to become Shihan or Kyoju. So that's the only term I found.
But when the students answer these questions, what kind of image do they have when, like, if I were to, if I were to be asked?
Because when I answer the question, I feel advanced player. I think should be able to teach the juniors. Mm-hmm. To teach the elementary level players. So yeah, I think my standard is like be able to teach in some way. Mm-hmm. So I will recommend it as like advanced. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
John, you had your hand.
I wonder how many are there any non-Japanese Shihan at the moment in Koto?
In Southeast Asia, we talk about Japan.
Do we know how many there are worldwide, or is there a large group of people?
I don't think so, but I think my guess is Sawai Koto School has an international network. Then they have some branches outside the University of California, San Diego, the Hawaii also has a branch. In Australia, they have. So the total number per school, Sawai has the biggest number. That's what I guess. If you are familiar with the Yokohama International School, Curtis Patterson is in Shihan. But I was I was looking at the, it was given by Kitai Sensei that just after the lunch, that this is a newsletter of Sawai School. It has actual questions of the certificate exam. Hyozo, Oshiki, Banshiki, if you know the Kagaku, you may be familiar with it, there will be the sort of age. Then the tricky about Koto learning is certification in Japan, of Koto Shihan in Japan requires shamisen. So you have to learn two instruments. But then learning shamisen is a bit difficult, very hard outside Japan because of the maintenance of the instrument. So in that sense, we have less, we are poor condition to get that those certification.
Other questions?
Yes,
thank you very much for introducing that case study and the survey. Last year I wrote a paper comparing Australian Koto and Moscow Koto situation and looking at the different conditions that were necessary for successful transplanting of those traditions. And one condition was having a permanent teacher, like in Sydney, Odama-san, who's been there for 30 years now, and that's been very significant. In Moscow, another important condition was the institutional context, where it was very strongly supported by the Moscow Conservatory, and most of the students, in fact, were Western music professionally, almost professional, so they learned. Anyway, there were various things like that. When you had your questions about is it okay for people to learn non-traditional pieces and so on, my understanding is that right from the Meiji period, Koto has been very affected by intercultural things, and Miyagi-michi, of course, starting with compositions which had a lot of Western influence in the post-war period.
Nakanoshima also.
Nakanoshima and post-war, Sanai-sensei, and a lot, and so all the Japanese trained people, and then post-war a lot of non-Japanese non-Western trained people start. So I think once Koto music leaves outside Japan, that is much more intense. So, for example, Odamana-san, after trying to very hard to just teach traditional Koto, she gradually came in contact with a lot of different musicians and people were composing for her over there. So I think it's inevitable, like when you said at the very last one, the student said, I will compose my own music, that is going to be what happens when the instrument goes outside Japan. And that reminds me of the discussion in the Noel panel just before with Diego, that the foreign learner wants something from it. They don't necessarily want to become part of the tradition in a Japanese sense, but to take something of it back into their own artistic context. So I don't know if I've asked a question.
Yeah, but those things actually, I think, eventually changed the system of learning and training. I don't know. If you compare it with the sumo, what's happening? Yeah, you don't have the Japanese yokozuna anymore. But what is happening is not the internationalization of sumo, but Japanization of foreign wrestlers. which model will happen to Japanese music, I'm not so sure. But the difference between no and koto is no has a quite rigid established training system. Then it involves many different parts, hayashi and But koto is, instrument can go anywhere itself. If you have an instrument, anybody actually try to create a music. So that, I think that's the main difference.
Okay, so on that note, let's take a break. Thank you very much.